So far we have discussed about computability with respect to Turing machines. Now, like in case of finite automata or push down automata, we have an equivalent formalism with respect to grammars also. So, in case of push down automata, we have called them as context free grammars. In case of finite automata, that is regular grammars or right linear grammars. So, we have discussed all those things and we have ascertained the equivalence between those classes. So, similarly, in case of Turing machines, we have a class of grammars, an equivalent set of grammars. So, here this is the most, as you understand, the Turing machine is defined for the utmost computability. That means, as a device which is useful to model the computation. This is the model of computation. So, grammar, whatever that we are going to talk about, that should also have enough facility to capture or to understand anything which is which you wanted to compute. So, in this lecture, I will talk about that more general type of grammars. So, we call this as because we have certain restrictions so far on the grammar in case of context free grammar or regular grammar. This is the one which is more in a relaxed fashion, that means the more general one, we call it as structured grammar or unrestricted grammar. So, the grammars that I am going to talk about here are structured or unrestricted. Are unrestricted grammars. So, now the question is, what is the what is the meaning of unrestriction? Like, if you look at, if you remember, in case of context free grammar, a production rule A goes to alpha, where this A is a non terminal symbol and this alpha is a mixer of terminals and non terminals, because if you write terminals by sigma, I wrote that as say V. So, alpha is an element of V star. As we just recollect that this A non terminal, because some for every production rule left side some non terminal has to be there. Otherwise, when you are applying a production rule, because for a terminal we have already agreed upon that when you want to apply, there has to be a non terminal on the left hand side of each production rule. Now, we relax this condition that left side only one non terminal symbol, that was the restriction that we were maintaining. So, we relax that condition. Now, what is the more general situation? The left side also you can have a mixer of terminals and non terminals, right side also mixer of terminals and non terminals. But you remember that if you want to apply a production rule, at least one non terminal has to be there. Suppose if you arrive to a terminal string in a derivation, then as we have seen, we do not expect anything further, because we have derived already a terminal string, that means the derivation ends there. So, there has to be at least one non terminal to apply any production rule. So, that condition we cannot relax. So, the more general scenario is left side a mixer of terminals and non terminals, but at least one non terminal has to be there, and the right side a mixer of terminal and non terminals as earlier. So, this unrestricted grammar, the production rule which is of the form say alpha goes to beta, where alpha is a mixer of terminals and non terminals, but at least one non terminal has to be there, that means it is an element of this set, and as earlier beta is an element of V star, where this V is non terminals union the terminal symbols. So, this is what we introduce. So, formally a structured grammar structured or unrestricted grammar, one may call it a simply grammar is a quadruple as earlier n sigma p s, where n finite set, because they are all as earlier finite set called non terminal symbols, and sigma is a finite set This is called terminal symbols, and S is the start symbol. S is a non-terminal, the start symbol. Now, this P, the production rules, it is a finite subset of V star N V star, that means at least one non-terminal has to be there on the left side cross V star, where V as given here. So, this is how formally we give it as a quadruple N sigma P S, like in case of context free grammars or regular grammars, we give the same notation. But here the production rules, it is a finite subset of V star N V star, that means left hand side of each production rule should have at least one non-terminal symbol, on the right hand side you will have a mixture of terminals and non-terminals. So, that is how formally an unrestricted grammar can be defined. Now, let me look at an example. I will not consider those examples which we have already established some regular grammars or context free grammars, because you can quickly see as a remark that every regular grammar is, you know, a context free grammar, and every context free grammar is a structured grammar, because left side you are allowed to use a mixture of terminals and non-terminals with at least one non-terminal. If you fix only one non-terminal on the left hand side, it is just boiling down to a context free grammar. Therefore, I am not going to give those examples which you have already established some context free grammars. So, let us look at the example, because we have this particular example that we have observed that this language, say x in a b c star, such that number of a's in x is same as number of b's in x is same as number of c's in x. Of course, just I put a restriction that at least it is a non-empty strings. So, we have observed that this is not context free language. Now, can we have a grammar for this, because we have a more relaxed, and you know, you have already constructed a Turing machine also for this. So, we can obviously, as I had mentioned, that these grammars that I am going to introduce here, they are equivalent to computational capacity with Turing machines. So, we will naturally expect a grammar for this. So, what kind of thing here? Context free grammar, it is not possible. So, the left side mixture of terminals and non-terminals sort of thing is required here. So, at least or more than one non-terminal symbol is required here. So, let us look at a grammar for this. You can quickly ascertain and understand that you have to generate ABC's equal number. So, first what I will do, I will take the production rule, say capital A, capital B, capital C. So, ABC when I will generate, and maybe I will put SS recursively, the number of ABC's whatever you want you generate. And then, so for example, by using these two rules you can quickly understand that, for example, if you want 2 A's, 2 B's, 2 C's, then you use the production rule SS, and 2 S you have generated, and S goes to ABC if you use two times, then you can get for corresponding to each capital letter. Of course, I will give the respective small letter, say A goes to A, B goes to little b, and C goes to little c. For example, I give it like this. Now, it is not that ABC's will be in the same order, because it can be mixed. For example, all A's come together, or so maybe some B's and A's are mixed, but C's may come together. So, whatever is the possibility, only restriction I have is number of A's and number of B's and number of C's should be same. So, what I will do, I will allow this non-terminal symbols A, B, C's, they can commute each other. So, for example, A, B can be B, A, whenever you have A, B, if you want B, A you can make. If you have B, A similarly, I will have a flexibility of making A, B. So, this A can commute with B, similarly A can commute with C, say A C can be C A can be A C, similarly B C can commute with C, that is B can commute with C, that is B C can be C B, or C B can be B C. Suppose if I give all these rules, you can quickly understand that the logic, the way that we have defined, you can understand that, you know, first what are the number of A's or number of B's, number of C's, they should be equal. So, you wanted to have in a particular string that many times you apply S recursively and get that n number, and once you have that required number of capital S, capital B's, capital C's, which are equal always, and then whatever the particular type of string you want, what are the permutation that you want, you permute this S, B, C's, capital S, capital B's, capital C's, and then you terminate with the terminal strings, and you can quickly generate whatever the string that you want in this language. Let me give an example. For example, if you want AB, ABCC, you can see that 2 A's, 2 B's, 2 C's are here. So, the derivation, as I had mentioned, you may first use SS, the production rule, and this S you can put ABC, and for this also you can put ABC. And now, do not terminate, first you arrange using that permuting rules and bring the form whatever that you want. For example, this AB can give this first AB, there is no problem, but you want another AB here. So, this C we will take. So, C can commute with A as well as B. So, I will use that rule. By commuting this, I will get AC, then I have BC, and you can commute this C with B also. So, I will get AB, A, B, C, C. Now, you can terminate this. A little capital A can go to little a. So, that is the situation here, and then this capital B. So, you finitely many times I simply write this A, you can bring this B, then A, then B, then little c, then little c. So, you know how many steps are required. I am putting just star here, finitely many steps. So, you have a derivation like this. So, quickly we can ascertain that the strings in this language can be generated, because as I had mentioned that at least one A or one B, one C has to be there, because number of A's equal to number of B's equal to number of C greater than equal to 1, 1 A, 1 B, 1 C has to be there, but whatever is the order. And the logic that I have defined, you can recursively give this and you can permute to the positions wherever that you want A's, B's, C's. So, these are the permuting rules, and thus any string in this language, you can observe that any string in this language can be generated. Of course, I have not defined formally the notion of this one step relation and the reflexive transitive closure of that. So, this can be, you know, as earlier in case of context free grammars. So, I am using this for one step relation, and its reflexive transitive closure is by star of this. Reflexive transitive closure of this one step relation. So, this one step relation, again, what is that? Given a string, if you can apply rule once and to get another string, say from alpha to beta, if you can get in by applying one production rule once, then we use this symbol between the strings as earlier. So, that is what, using these two, we have defined, we have shown that S derives this particular string AB, AB, CC. So, as earlier, for a grammar G, language generated by G is set of all x in sigma star such that S derives x infinitely many steps, where S is the start symbol of the grammar. So, all these definitions, this one step relation definition or reflexive transitive closure of that, and the language generated by grammar as earlier. So, we are not going into details of this, but we will just see like what are the languages that you can generate using structured grammars or unrestricted grammars, this kind of grammars. So, if you recall, let me look at this example. This is set of all x, I can simply write like this, is a power n, b power n, c power n such that n greater than or equal to 1, for example. Once again, we have observed that this particular language is not context free. We have used pumping lemma for context free languages, and we have realized that this language cannot be generated by a context free grammar. This is not a context free language. Now, again the question is, can we have a structured grammar for this? So, for this particular language, we have designed the Turing machine also. You have that.
Now, one wants that, we do not have that flexibility, we have certain restrictions. Maybe let me define like this, I want to generate, because n greater than equal to 1, some a b c has to be generated, and then say let me give recursion and s t, say t may be like this. And here the idea is as follows, this t counts the how many this commutes with this t commutes with this little c, and whenever you have this b t c, we will make this t essentially generates the respective number of b c's, say b b c c. So, if I give an example, then you will realize that it generates a power n, b power n, c power n. You can see that if you want just a b c to be generated, it is not a big deal. You just get in one step using the first rule, there is no problem, because s goes to a b c is a rule. If you want, so this can be generated. If you want a square, b square, c square, say 2 a's, 2 b's, 2 c's in that order. If you want, you see, I use this rule a s t, and then this s with this rule a b c we terminate, this t is there. So, t takes care of, you know, generating the respective number of b's and c's as per that we have used. So, this t can commute with c and come inside. So, what I get like this, a b t c. Now, b t c can give this another, because each t will generate a pair of b c's. So, a b b c c. So, this is what the string that we wanted in this language. So, this production rules, that the way that I have defined, look at that, because this s can produce as many s as you want, and a t is the check corresponding to each s, you are having a t. So, this t will generate the respective number of b's and c's in the appropriate position. So, for that purpose, this t has to be, you know, moved in between that b's and c's. Because if t is not moved, then what will happen, this b's and t's when you are generating, you know, you require to generate them in this particular pattern. After b's, then c's should come, and after once you have c, then there should not be any b. So, that is the reason that we have to allow this rule that t commutes with little c, and you will be able to generate then the respective in the respective pattern. So, just for the sake of, you know, familiarity, just if you want a typical a power n, b power n, c power n, then what you have to do is you use this rule for n number of times to generate a power n, then what will happen here, st when I am using. So, here every time I get a power n s, then this t power n, that is what we get. Now, you see, so n minus 1 times we use, and then this you terminate with a b c, a power n minus 1 a b c t n, that is how we have to do. So, what do you have, this is a power n b c t. Now, you bring t inside, 1 t. So, a power n b t c t power n minus 1, this is how you have. Then this you can generate now 2 b's, say b b c c, then t power n minus 1, and so on. You keep bringing this t's inside to generate the respective number. Now, you have 2 b's here, a b c t power n minus 1, sorry. So, this will be n minus 2. So, 2 b's and 2 c's are already there. The respective number of t's you bring inside, and after finitely many steps, you get a power n, b power n, c power n. So, this is a typical derivation in this particular grammar. Now, what I have observed, you take any string which is of the form a power n, b power n, c power n, because anyway a to b to c to I have already observed, assume n greater than n greater than 2, in which case you just use this kind of rules AST for n minus 1 times, so that you get a power n minus 1 s t power n minus 1. After getting this a power n minus 1 you have, then s you will terminate with a b c, then you have a, n a's, then you have 1 b c here, and it n minus 1 t's you have. So, those n minus 1 t's you bring inside to produce the respective number of b c's again side by side. So, that means this t has to commute with the c's whatever that so far you have generated, then t will come between b's and c's, there you terminate that t by generating one more pair, that b c. So, that is how we will generate a n, b n, c n. So, by this what do we understand? This language a power n, b power n, c power n, such that n greater than or equal to 1 is a subset of the language generated by g. Now, we have to look for the converse. That means whatever that is generated by this grammar, the string is of the form a power n, b power n, c power n, for which we have to look at the characteristic properties of each rule. Here I have two non-terminal symbols s and t. Unless I use this rule a b c, the s cannot be avoided, that is what is the property. So, if you start with the start symbol s, unless I use the rule a s goes to a b c, we will always have the non-terminal symbol s, in because there are only possibility that I can use a s t. So, I will be producing this many number of t's. Now, to avoid this t, that means to terminate this capital T, I have to use this production rule. I can use this production rule if I have this t in between b and c. So, I have to use this commuting rule if I have produced certain c's and so on. So, you use, there are only very few rules, 1, 2, 3, 4 rules only. So, observe that applicability of the 4 rules, and then you argue that the language generated by the grammar is a subset of this set a power n, b power n, c power n, such that n greater than or equal to 1. Thus, we conclude that this language generated by this particular grammar is this language, we have this equality. So, this is one phase of grammars, but as I had mentioned that these are having the power of Turing machines. Turing machines are used as language generators or as a computing devices, because we have talked about Turing computable functions. Between strings, a Turing computable function is the one to compute that particular function, you should require a Turing machine. Now, an equivalent or a parallel mechanism or a parallel concept of computability in case of grammars that we will introduce. So, that is, let me give you this formally, the definition as in case of Turing machines, let sigma 1 and sigma 2 be two alphabet, a function f from sigma 1 star to sigma 2 star is said to be grammatically computable. Earlier we have talked about Turing computability, now we are calling it grammatically computable. Grammatically computable if there is a grammar say n sigma p s, where this sigma 1, sigma 2 are subsets of this sigma, and there are strings, let me call say u v, u dash, v dash in v star, we call them as n markers, we call them as end markers, such that for x in sigma 1 star, y in sigma 2 star, if y is image of x under f, if and only if u x v from u x v infinitely many steps in g, you should be able to get u dash y v dash. Look at the similarity of the Turing computability with this grammatically computable function. Now, just recall, a function is said to be Turing computable if there is a Turing machine such that if y is image of x under f, then by giving x as input in the initial state, you should be able to get y as output, and conversely I mean this if and only if. That means, by giving x as input, whenever you are getting y as output in a Turing machine, what is the condition? That y has to be image under f of x. So, the same thing here, in place of the Turing machine, we are talking about through a grammar, but here there is nothing like, you know, giving input and output. Therefore, we are talking with respect to certain end markers, and if you want to say a particular function is grammatically computable with respect to a particular grammar, for that particular grammar you have to first declare these are the end markers. So, these are the starting end markers. In this particular context, we are choosing u v, and the ending end markers we are choosing u dash v dash. It is similar to, you know, initializing a Turing machine, and you know, you are stopping a Turing machine, halting a Turing machine by giving the output. In a similar fashion, here we had to introduce the end markers, because otherwise in case of grammars, we are generating grammar through start symbol. Here start symbol will not play any role, but anyway the grammar, that start symbol is a component. So, we are anyway considering that fourth component as well in the grammar, but here the end markers are important. When you want to say a particular function is grammatically computable, we have to fix the end markers for that particular grammar to compute that particular function. Now, look at this definition. Take two alphabets, say sigma 1 and sigma 2. A function from sigma 1 star to sigma 2 star is said to be grammatically computable if there is a grammar n sigma p s, where sigma 1, sigma 2 subsets of sigma, and there are strings, these are the end markers u v, u dash v dash, for the purpose of, you know, the starting and ending we are using. So, u v, u dash v dash is elements of v star, such that whenever y is image of x under f, then you should be able to have this kind of derivation, and between these end markers, whenever you have these terminal strings x and y with the property that x is in sigma 1 star and y is in sigma 2 star, then y has to be image of x under f. So, this condition is very strict, this is if and only if condition. So, using this condition, we will be establishing that the Turing computable functions are also grammatically computable, and vice versa. But let me demonstrate first how to construct such grammars through certain examples, then we will see accordingly. So, let me consider a simple example. It is a very easy example to understand this, because grammar generating languages you know very well, but this is little bit different. So, let me first consider, say, sigma to be, say, a b. So, a b star to a b star, a simple function, this f 1 I am defining. If you take any x, I simply concatenate a to x. So, you can clearly see this is a function, it is grammatically computable. What is the grammar I consider? So, let me consider the grammar g to b, say, anyway start symbol since you require, let me take this, that itself as a start symbol, and special symbol some dollar and some cent, some this pound symbol let me use, and the terminals a b, the production rules I give you, and yes is that. And the production rules, what do I give? I give as follows. If I have a and with cent, I will simply give, or I do not require anything, because I have to produce A, I will just give this as a production rule, just only one production rule. So, what is the idea here? I declare the end markers U to be this dollar and V to be this cent I give, and U dash same dollar, but V dash I declare it as this pound symbol. So, the idea here while giving this particular production rule, whatever that string x that I consider, I consider with these end markers dollar and cent, and after finitely many steps, whatever that y I wanted to have, that is the this end marker I am taking the same, and but this end marker with this pound. I do not get this pound unless I apply this production rule. I apply this production rule whenever I have this cent, I simply concatenate A. You can quickly see that using these rules, any string that you consider a1, a2, an, this dollar and with this cent, you apply that production rule only once, and then you can get the same a1, a2, an you have, whatever is that string, then you concatenate A and terminate. So, only one step derivation that you have in this grammar, because only one production rule, wherever cent is there, I will simply concatenate A and produce pound, and since this is the end marker for right side and this is for the left side, the same thing that we have considered. So, here within one step, I get the image of x under this function f 1, and hence, so every thing that you can compute in one step only. So, you can quickly see that f 1 is grammatically computable function. So, this f 1 is grammatically computable. Let me extend this just conditionally, because unconditionally we are putting there. So, if f 2 is, if f 2 is same a b star to a b star defined by f 2 of any x is equal to, let me write y a if x is of the form say y b, and it is y b if it is of the form y a epsilon else. So, look at the definition of the function. If the string x is terminating with b, if the ending symbol is b, then I have to remove that b and I have to place by a, and vice versa. Whenever I have a, I have to place it by b, and if it is empty string, it is empty only. So, for a non-empty strings, at least a or b you should have. So, you can quickly tell me that what are the production rules that you require. Same earlier, if you have a with cent, I just give b with pound, and b with cent if you have, and say a with pound you give. And this is important, because dollar with cent, that means if the input is empty string, then you have, you require this rule. So, these three rules let me consider. Now, the respective grammar G, you know what are the non-terminal symbols, etcetera. So, this is the P for this grammar. Now, the idea here is with the U dash, I am taking the same dollar, but V to be cent and V dash is the pound, that is what we are considering. So, if you take any string a 1, a 2, a n with the start symbols, this dollar and cent, and now what happens, this a n based on this a n, if a n is a, then it is of the form y a, I require b. So, this a n cent, that is a cent will become b. So, here are the possibilities, this dollar is same, a 1, a 2, a n minus 1, and that a n, if a n is equal to a, then a cent you can make it as b pound, and if that a n is b, this will become in one step a 1, a 2, a n minus 1. By applying this second rule, you will have a pound, and If n equal to 0, then you have this dollar and cent side by side, and hence in one step you can produce this. And thus, with the end markers, the beginning end markers u v and the ending end markers, that means by the time of terminating this derivation, of course, here also every derivation is in one step that you are getting. Let me consider a little better example. Of course, we have talked about the definition of grammatically computable functions from strings to strings. As in case of Turing machines, we can talk about this grammatically computable function or numbers also. When I am talking about numbers, as earlier, we will talk with respect to unary representation. So, let me consider a simple function, that is successor function from I star. In the unary representation, the natural numbers are considered I star. That means, essentially I am considering S from natural numbers to natural numbers defined by S of n is equal to n plus 1, the successor function. So, here that S is taking i power n plus 1, as we have constructed earlier, you can see this is grammatically computable, this particular example. Now, similarly, if you want to talk about predecessor function from natural numbers to natural numbers, defined by P of n is equal to n minus 1 if n greater than equal to 1, 0 if n equal to 0. So, for that we have to be little bit careful, that whatever the number of i's you are given, if there is an i sent the way that you are defining, I sent, you can make it as, say, for example, pound, so that one I is killed, the last one. If there is no I, then the scenario is that you have dollar and cent side by side, and hence, so essentially you have to check the condition, because earlier you can simply define that produce one more I at the end by changing the symbol, you will get it. That means, let me give you, because dollar and cents consistently if I am using, I can give you the production rule like this. Whenever I have cent, I will simply make I pound, that is all. So, what are the number of I's existing, n number of I's, one more I is appended and you declare that pound to be the v dash. But in this case, in case of predecessor function, you have to cross check. That means, as earlier, if you have this I sent, then you can make it pound. So, one I is killed, and otherwise, if there are no I's, then that means this dollar and cent will be side by side, then you make this is dollar pound. So, you if you consider these two rules, you can quickly see that predecessor function or natural numbers, using unary representation with number of I's, we can see that it is, they are grammatically computable. Let me consider another example, which let me stick to A B for the time being, say F from, let me write R, A B star to A B star defined by R of x is reversal of x, reversal of x. If whenever you are considering a 1 a 2 a n, the string, the image is a n minus 1 and so on a 1, the reversing the string. So, this is little bit tricky. We have to be careful with the end markers and how we have to pursue this job, we have to look at. Now, let me fix maybe end markers like this. Some bracket, this dollar x, this bracket, this is with this pair end marker u, and this is with v. After finitely many steps, I would like to produce this x power r, this dollar, this. So, here u to be the square bracket dollar and v to be the square bracket, and u dash is the square bracket, v dash to be this dollar and square bracket. With these end markers, I will pursue the job. So, here what I will do, whenever I am considering this a1, a2, an, this dollar, the idea is like this. This square bracket, the terminal symbol, whenever it is touching, this particular terminal symbol corresponding to that, I will create one non-terminal symbol, some non-terminal symbol, and I will allow this non-terminal symbol to commute with each of these terminal symbols here and pass through this dollar. Whenever it is passing through the dollar, I will make that as a the respective terminal symbol. For example, if it is A, I will make it as a capital A. Okay, let me not use this because you may think this is the production rule. So, I will convert this as capital A, and if it is small b, I will convert this as capital B. So, that is how I will choose. So, whenever this is touching this right side bracket, the respective capital letters that I am considering, these capital letters can commute with any of the small letters here, so that it will go here, and after crossing this dollar, I will leave them back. That means, if the capital A is crossing this dollar, I will make it as a small letter. If the capital B is crossing this, then I will make it as a small b. Thus, you will understand that x power r can be generated through this mechanism. Let me give the rules. So, the idea is this. If I have little a with this bracket, the idea is to create the capital A in that place. Similarly, if you have little b touching to the right side bracket, I will give the rule that it will be made capital B. And this capital A and capital B should be able to go through this little a's and little b's. So, that means, this little a capital A, the capital A little a, that means, A can pass through this, and similarly, it can pass through b also. The same property with b's, A capital B is this, and if you have little b capital B, then b. Now, this capital A, whenever it is touching dollar, what do? We convert this back to its original form, that is a dollar. Similarly, this dollar, the capital B is touching this dollar, once it passed to that place, we will leave it back to little b dollar. Now, you look at through an example. So, these are the production rules I am considering. These are how many? These are 4 here, the 4 here, total 8 production rules. This is what is the production rule set. You know the grammar here. Of course, for start symbol purpose, you can take dollar as a start symbol, does not matter. So, dollar I have used, and this square brackets, what else? Capital A and capital B. These are the non-terminal symbols under consideration, and terminal symbols little a, little b only I have, and p as given there, and this yes. So, this is the quadruple under consideration. This grammar computes this function, making a string reversal. How it pursues? Let us look at an example. Suppose, I am considering a, b, b. What is the form that I am considering? Dollar, this bracket and this bracket. Now, using that rule 2, little b with the bracket can be converted to capital B bracket. So, I have this a, b, this is capital B. Now, this capital B can pass through this little a's and little b's. So, what will happen? This dollar. Now, you have two possibilities of applying production rule. You can pass this b through a and make little b, and systematically you can go for the second symbol, or if you want to make this little b again capital B, because this small b is touching the right side bracket. So, let me for fun consider this way. Look at these symbols cannot commute among themselves, these capital letters b and b cannot commute themselves. So, the first symbol can commute with small letters only. This a you cannot now convert unless you pass these symbols. So, let me pass now dollar, this capital B, a, b. So, what I want to point out here, whatever the order that the capital letters are generated, in that order only they will pass through dollar. The order cannot be changed, because this capital letter can commute with only small letters, And these capital letters will become small letters after passing through dollars. So, the order, whatever the way that they are converted to capital letters, will not be changed. That is what one has to observe here. Now, this capital B is touching this dollar. So, you just pass through that and now becoming the small letter. This is how you are, you have. Now, this little a, unless it becomes capital letter, it cannot pass through dollar. And so, unless you get that particular position, you are unable to do that. So, that order is taken care here. Now, pass B through this little a. So, you have this, and now this capital B passes through this, becomes small letter, this and a, B B, this dollar can become now capital letter. So, this is now B B A dollar, and you see the end markers U dash V dash you have achieved. This is U dash as declared, U dash is left side bracket, and V dash now is dollar with this bracket. And for empty string, you do not have to apply any rule. Quickly, you can see that if it is empty string, the input is of this form here epsilon, and it is 0 number of steps here. Let me write star in 0 number of steps. In fact, you can see that because these two strings are essentially same. Now, in a general case, let us see what is happening. In a general case, if you consider a 1, a 2, a n, if you consider a 1, a 2, a n, this becomes capital A n, a 1, this is capital A n, it may be capital A or capital B. I am writing A n corresponding to this. This A n can commute and pass through this. After finitely many steps, this A n comes here, becomes small a n dollar, this A 1 A n minus 1. And similarly, this a n dollar a 1, say capital A n minus 1, this may be capital A or capital B. Again, this passes through all these letters, finitely many steps, and now pass through this dollar, become a n minus 1, this dollar a 1 and so on, a n minus 2. Yes. Now, you notice that a n has first crossed dollar, its position is maintained, and a n minus 1 is the second symbol to pass through this dollar. So, a n minus 1 and so on. So, this symbol at the last, a 1 will be passed through this dollar and will be at the end, and dollar will be next to this. So, you will get after finitely many steps using the same process, a n minus 1 and so on, a 1 dollar. By the time a 1 passes, this dollar will be next to this. So, that you will get the final end markers, this v dash and this is u dash. And whatever is the string which is formed this way, and if this dollar is going to next to this, you can realize that this will be the reversal of the given string. So, that you can understand that the reversal can be forming reversal is a grammatically computable function. So, all these things that we have done in case of Turing machines, because given x as input, x power r how to create, or you know, given x, maybe let me do that kind of thing. If I give g from say a b star to a b star, g of x is equal to x x power r. So, this kind of all such functions we have observed through Turing machines, that we can create this kind of strings. If x is there, to create x power r next to that, this kind of things are, you know, over numbers, computing over numbers, all those things that we have done through Turing machines. The same thing, whatever that you have done, that computable, whatever the computable function that you have observed through Turing machine, you can observe through grammars also. Now, for the sake of the generalization, because you have handled with two strings, three strings as input and so on, n number of strings as input. Only thing is here I have to have certain notation. The n markers, say for example, u v that you are fixing, if you want to give n number of strings as input, you may separate with some special symbol like this, as in case of Turing machine, x 1, x 2 and so on, x n. we were separating through some special symbols, and whatever the output that you wanted after finitely many steps, u dash, v dash, in between suppose if you want to generate m number of strings, say y1, say special symbol, some blank symbol that I am using, assume this is not the part of the input alphabet. If you can do this, then we say some sigma 1 cross sigma 1 star cross sigma 2 and so on, sigma n star to, for example, sigma, okay, let me use some other sets, a star a 1 star cross a 2 star and so on, alphabet, some alphabet a m star. So, this kind of strings, the computable functions in a general case of this form can also be discussed. For example, now you consider two numbers giving as input in unary representation and then, you know, calculating sum of those two numbers, product of two numbers or division. So, whatever is the computable functions that we have handled through Turing machines, the similar things that you can handle here. And maybe we will discuss some of the examples through grammatically computable function. Showing grammatically computable function is, you know, is much easier than creating a very cumbersome Turing machine. So, we will discuss few more examples and then see. So, meanwhile, whatever the simple Turing computable functions that we have discussed, they are all can be taken as exercise to show them as grammatically computable functions. That means, the respective grammars that you have to create and show that these are grammatically computable functions.